Good morning, everybody, and also welcome from my side to the presentation of technology and product roadmap. As usual, I would like to give you some details on our strategy, on our, let's say, future plans. It's basically also always a technical presentation, but I would like to try it to make it understandable for everyone. Please also consider that things which are mentioned for the future releases might change, or there might be modifications for the future releases, as usual. It's a plan. Everything we consider and everything we talk about, it always starts with the question: what is important for the user? Because the user is finally deciding for a product, to buy a product, and finally also using the product. As a fact for us, the better we understand the user, the better we also address his needs, his wishes, and realize them, the better is the benefit, or the more benefit we get finally out of it. So if we consider and put ourselves a little bit inside a user who's selecting a product, so the first thing he might think, the whole thing must be useful for me. So I need really something which enables my use cases, which is really great from the utility and also from integration points of view. And the other part is also sustainability, because I would like to use it for a long period of time. I would like that the software is doing what it should do, and it's really stable. So this is the major core part when a customer or a user looks at the software. The second level, of course, he's somehow saying, yeah, I would like to use it. I would like to extend it. I would like to configure it in a way that I can do this. It should be easy for me. I should do this alone. And the next thing is even that we think, yeah, the user should be really addressed or in a nice way. So the look and feel should be great for him. It should be appealing. And the user should really have the desire to own the product, to buy it, and to use it. So overall, these are some levels, let's say, we consider all the time. And in fact, another level is the deployment, the accessibility, and it should be a cloud system. So more and more users are asking us. So yeah, as you also know, and as you see from the sales side, it should be deployed, it should be available from the cloud. That means it's a shorter, fast, easy on-ramp on the one hand side. On the other hand side, it's an easy extension. And of course, they always get all the benefits from a SaaS solution. There's no local hardware necessary. There's always the latest version available. And of course, you have to pay as you use. In fact, for us, the key success factor is a deep understanding of the user and the user needs. So that's why we put also lots of effort in this. So we are undergoing, for instance, with the customer success calls to the customer. We are sending out our product POs, so the product owners, to the customer's field to understand how they work with the product, what they would like to know. We have extended the web client with some features and also in the cloud, so we can ask, we can pull questions, we can get feedback from the customer side. We have the insights. We have also the possibility then also to end user conferences to talk to the users. And finally, also we talk with you on these sales events like the DockerWorld about our users. Overall, this helps us really to get a deep user understanding. So finally, from this understanding what we currently have and what we'd also talked about since the last time we lost DockerWorld already in a similar way, we derived our strategy. So it's sophisticated technology, easy to use, which means there are four major things for us which I would like to introduce now. And these are the similar things as you have seen also last DockerWorld. So the first thing is, of course, is the modern cloud solution. So in terms of high performance, reliability, scalability, low operation costs from our side to really guarantee attractive price points, easy to trial, and also having a modern architecture behind. On the next level, we touched it already. So it's the high usability from our perspective and intuitive design. So here we really would like to see and continue easy configuration in the usage, support this intuitive interaction, clear user guidance, and also visual attractiveness. The third thing, of course, We need utilities, we need functionality, so rich utility and flexible integration capabilities, cover most of the important use cases, fulfill advanced business needs, and also deliver inspiring innovations once in a while. And then the fourth point becomes also a very critical part for us. It's really outstanding technical quality. So here, high stability, backward compatibility, our major point, compliance with certifications, high security standards, newest technologies, and also stable processes to bring us there. So these are the four major strategic areas, and I would like to go in the presentation step by step through each of them and explain what we're going to do, what are the achievements with Docker 7, and also what are our future plans. So let's start with the Docker Cloud. So as you know, we already have a great, unique, comprehensive cloud offering, which none of our competitors has in this way. It's a multi-tenant public cloud offering since 2012 already, so we have half-year updates. We have a technology and also feature parity from the cloud and also the on-premise systems. We have the possibility to establish hybrid cloud solutions, for instance, with the file cabinet synchronization and local data connector. We have a highly secure solution. On the one hand side, of course, we are using the security functions of our Dockerware platform, but we also undergo certifications like the ISO 27001, SOC2, and also HIPAA certifications. And of course, we are also using Azure data centers, which have their own security, great security. So also here from the Azure data centers, this is the other point. With them, we are able to expand easily, even worldwide in other data centers. And the last point is the whole cloud is really developed and operated using DevOps, modern DevOps methods. So overall, this is a great thing, and we have great achievements based on this platform and all your sales success in the last year. So I just, maybe this is repeating what was there already, but these are the key numbers from my side, so impressive success factors from our cloud. So last year, we grew on the customer side by 139%. It's really great. We had at the end of the year 1,305 customers on the cloud systems, EMEA and US together, and we had about 45% of our new customers choosing already the cloud system. So these are impressive numbers. We heard this already, really, really great, and thank you also for your sales success. On the other side, the usage statistics, what's behind? There are some numbers, some of them you heard already, some not. These are some figures from end of February 2018. So we had about 3,500 organizations on the cloud system. So 3,500 organizations. Each single on-premise system is one organization, right? So, and considering here, organizations are from us. On the one hand side, these are trial systems. On the other hand, these are your partner systems, and these are the paid customer systems. We have more than 50,000 users on the systems at the moment. This is a growth of 121% in 2017. 37 users in average per account, and the maximum we really have, there's really an organization with 2,500 customers, which is here in the US. There are documents in total 55 million, which we are handling at the moment is a growth of 244% in 2017. We add about 40,000 documents a day last year, and maybe the interesting thing is also the ones that are more technical, maybe the other index jobs which are running on the system currently, there are 3,000 jobs and tasks running all the time. These are impressive numbers, and I would like to go a little bit deeper now on the platform, the whole cloud platform, to explain a little bit more what is behind, what we have done with Docker 7, and what will be the future of the cloud platform. I split it up in 8 components, and I would like to go through it in 5 steps, that you can really digest what we have there and that this is clear for you. And I would like to start with the core element. The core element is our existing multi-tenant Dockerware platform, which we have also on sell also on-premise, which is also the core platform in the cloud. As you know, this platform is a modern standard platform for digitalization and process automation, small, medium, and partly large enterprises. The other thing is leading by architecture and technology. We are flexible and powerful in terms of supported use cases with already out-of-the-box functionality inside for the document management. We developed over years, reflecting really the customer needs. That's why we are successful, and we use it by 18,000 customers worldwide with 500,000 users in 17 countries. So this is the base. This is what we have now, and we heard yesterday that, let's say, there's a trend which Gartner put out that the let's say, terminology of ECM and also document management will be in future content services, and I would like to highlight this a little bit, how this platform looks like as a content service platform. So Gartner put out a definition, which I would like to touch only the bold one. So a content services platform, as they think of, is providing a broad set of capabilities for managing content. Okay. Very rough. Then the other thing is content service platforms provide an underlying set of repository services to manage and store content, as well as broad range of functional elements. So just here we have repository services and we have functional elements. And there is something down there also which talks about integrating capabilities. And if you put this, if you think a little bit further, there are maybe three major points we have to consider for a content services platform. So the first is really that we have repository services and as they call it, functional elements. I come to this later. The second thing is that the whole platform is somehow integratable and extendable, as it means there's no monolithic core thing which is not extendable, which is not touchable. And so these are the main things here. The third thing is, of course, that we can build, based on these things, additional services, so that they are really reusable, that we can make additional things out of it. And I think this is already the idea we had since many, many years for our platform. This is built in this way, and this is done in this way. And I would like just to show you and highlight our, let's say, core Dockerware platform in this content services, way. So the base thing is content repository services. They are on the one hand side organizational management, there are repository operations and data storage. All this is about user rights management, this is about authentication, this is about logging, this is about backup recovery, this is about file access, storage access, encryption, and so on. All this is the base thing, this is the core of our platform. On top, we were saying, so also Gartner was establishing, these are functional or utility services. So here we say, this is for sure, these are the document management, the core document management functionalities, import, capture, classification, extraction. It's productivity for single team or for single users and teams. So this is all what we have. This is storage, this is searching, this is annotating, this is viewing, this is collaborating, this is notification. And so on, retention, management, all this we see as core, let's say, content service utilities. And of course, we have the process automation and workflow part. Users can access these services, what we have, from the web UIs. They can configure and administrate it, they can use it, and they can also access it from the desktop UI and also from the mobile UI, right? So this is what we currently have. The other side, there are three ways of integrating with these services there. So there's the SDK API for implementations. There are plug and play integrations like UL integration and our Smart Connect, for instance. And there are predefined, pre-implemented connectors and integrations like a Connect to Outlook, like a Connect to SAP, like Connect to MFPs. So these are integration possibilities. On the other hand side, we still have the deployment. So server deployment means there's a server setup, we have the deployment for the mobile side, and we have the client setup. So doesn't it look like it's a modern content services platform, right? So this is what we always did, and I just showed it in a way that it really reflects this terminology. Around this, we have also four, let's say, cornerstones we always considered in our development. So technology leading, this is one thing, from the technical side, from the architecture side, The other side, always high scalability from what we do. High scalability means here from the tenants, multi-tenancy, users, data, and operations. Then we have the high configuration on all these levels, so from bottom to up, so repository services, utilities, and also UI level, you have configuration possibilities. And of course, you have a high security means in the system, data access and storage. So this is really, in my point of view, a great modern content services platform. What was the goal now for Docker version 7? What did we want to achieve? I think the increasing usage, what we had, is basically the large-scale requirements coming from the cloud side, but also coming from larger on-premise systems, and also our experience over the years made us rethink really to rework the base, the core thing, mainly repository part, and we did it just to reflect all these needs we had. It's the largest project we started 2-3 years ago. The last 9 months were more intensive, but this is overall what we see, the largest project in Dockerware since ever. And the focus was really what you could see here, availability, scalability, performance, and maintainability. I would like to show you the results now. And the main thing, what we did, is so-called File Cabinet 7. That's why it's also version 7, because the file cabinet looks a little bit different than before. And what we did here, the previous known content server is gone. So this was the 13 years old code, and we replaced it by a library. By the library, we means before all the components needed to go through the single element of content server. And now we have the library function, the same functionality in the library, and this library can be plugged in all the services we have inside the platform. So this is much more flexible. I don't have this hook over the content server. And all the other platforms means front-end, platform, web client, and also back-end, BPS, and so on. They can really directly use the data storage layer because there's this plug-in inside the service. This is much faster. So we don't have to hop over the server anymore. The other thing is what we did inside document operations are mainly now in the database first, and only afterwards we do an asynchronous writing of the header file, because header file or even file operations are slow. And even if we would like to view a document, we have things like last accessed user, and we write this to the file. So, and this is something we now decoupled a little bit. We do the database operation, which is pretty fast, and asynchronously a little delay writing the header files. The other thing what we did, just as an example, is splitting old and new document versions. This makes the search much faster, because normally you're searching only in new documents. Okay, so these libraries, as I said already, can be plugged in all front-end and back-end services. And together with the thing what we already established, the business process service, so this is what the engine, what is handling all the back-end things, which is already high performance and scalable in itself. And there we had auto-index requests, deletion, and export already ported to it, but the sync will still come in 7.1. This all together enables us really to have a clear separation between the platform front-end, the back-end, so there are no dependencies anymore that we had, and we can scale both things as we like. And this is really what we wanted to achieve. On the other side, there are some additional changes we made. The new desktop connection using the platform API instead of the job server, so the job server is gone. It's much faster and more stable. This is something we achieved. Then we enabled the platform also setting service to be 64-bit services to really use the memory. Dockerware Kinetic Solution support. You heard about Dockerware Kinetic Solutions. And here, technically, what we made is the possibility that you can dump configurations as a file out and load it in a new organization so that you have this kinetic or this settings set up in the new organization. You have a new logging implemented now through all the system to have the full usage there for maintainability reasons. And we implemented a new server setup completely new. You only have three variants to choose from, front-end, back-end, and full text. So these are the components, what you see also in the architecture. This is all, these are only the only things you can install, pretty easy for everyone. And it's implemented in a way that's more scalable, it's really faster, more interactive, so you see the feedbacks much better, transparent and stable. These are technical achievements, and I mentioned already several times there are performance increases. This was one of the major goals also behind, besides scalability. And there are some figures here. Overall, across all the board, all the functions operations are two-digit increase. So we measured this also compared to the baseline 612 and just 800 user machines and so on. So we really tested this out several times. And these are some highlights what I show here. I don't go deeper, just leave it as it is. The only thing I would like to point out is also CPU consumption, which is important for us as a cloud provider. It's over the board a 30% reduction. So this is pretty important for us from the pricing and usage perspective. So these are really great achievements, and you will see it. So overall, technical-wise, we have achieved what we wanted. Clear tree architecture, so we really now have a three clear levels. The GUI part, the logic part, the storage part, the quantum leap on scalability, this is something we have, and performance and maintainability. It's really a huge step forward for us and all changes for the cloud and also for the on-premise world, because it's used in both. So this, I would like to jump back to the overall cloud view. So we talked only about, let's say, the known multi-tenant Dockerware platform now, from now. I would like to touch on the other components now, starting with Cloud Gateway Service and infrastructure services. These are the things which enable us to deploy these things in the cloud in a much better way, so the platform in a much better way adapted to be more efficient on the cloud side. So the main thing here, the main idea on this service side is that I don't use only virtual machines on the Azure side, where I have to take care still about operating systems changes, about database updates and so on. So we didn't want this. And the Azure, the advantage of the Azure platform is that I have it as a platform as a service. That means there are services inside which are managed from Microsoft, managed from the Azure side. And we can just reuse them. And our task was, of course, to adapt our system using these services instead of just virtual machines. This is really for us, an important step. So we're using, for instance, for all incoming traffic on the upper layers, or the gateway services, as we call them, firewall, load balancer, and SSL TSL endpoints. And down there on the back end, we use Azure SQL, Azure Files, Azure Blob, Azure Service Bus, Azure Virtual Network, and Azure Key Vault. So this is, these are the adaptations we make when we deploy Dockerware, the core Dockerware in Azure. So with this, of course, we increase the stability and availability much more than we just using virtual machines. The scalability, maintainability for our side, much more improved, and the cost reduction is the same thing. So the next things are more, let's say, for operational reasons, some services, we call them cloud system service and cloud customer services. System services are something, for instance, for task scheduling. If you have so many organizations running on one system, you need task scheduling. You have lots of things in the monitoring area to really see what's going on the platform, availability checks, end-to-end performance tests, and something like a content delivery network for instance, for the client rollouts. So the new update backup, the new backup management was done with 6.12 because we have to handle huge amount of data meanwhile. We have to be much faster with backing this up and also with the restore, handling this huge data. And we added with 7 now a pre-rendering, new pre-rendering to be faster in the rendering documents. Cloud customer services, on the other hand, are more towards the tenant. So it's tenant handling services. These are trials, consumption, payment, licensing. So these are all these things I need on this side, and here we completely rewrote the service which is responsible for the contract management or tenant contract management with Dockerware 6, 12, and 7 to replace the one we had since 2012. It is, again, higher level data protection and higher performance. This is more on the backup side, optimized stable tenant handling, and also optimized cloud operations from our side. Then there are two more things here, additional cloud utility services and custom UIs. These are specific functions which are only for cloud customers, which are not in the main platform available, and also GUIs. So examples are for specific cloud utilities, FTP upload, local data connector, so everyone knows this. We added here with 6.12 cloud compatible connect to SAP. We added cloud compatible validation because we took it away. We cannot use it, the old one in the cloud, so we add both with 6.12. We added now with 7, or we did a step in the Active Directory integration. So user sync with new organizations is the first step. And we have also a new generation of cloud trials, including Kinetic solutions. On the other side, from the GUI side, so these are examples what I have here. So it's the portal, it's the status page, it's the performance page. And there, what we did here, this customer performance portal, maybe you've seen this already, this is pretty old since 6.11, old means one year. So, and the cloud portal redesign and trial generation, we did new with 6.12, and the customer names, and custom domain specific URLs. We enabled this with 6.12 and already rolled it out now during the timeline of 7. So these are some extensions we did here on this side. Provisioning of new enterprise level utilities is really something what we could see in reworked portals and UIs for professional use. This brings me back to the last part here. This is maybe the slimmest, but we also put lots of effort in this because it's pretty important from our side. It's the cloud deployment, the service update, and overall rollout. On the one hand side, what we did for the service deployment, we use now a state-of-the-art technology. It's called Docker deployment. So before, what we did, we deployed files here and there and so on. What we do now, we split it, the build in the services we also use in the cloud environment. These services then can be packed into so-called containers. We just take them and deploy them as a service on a certain machine, because there are still services we have to do. And these are much better, much fault tolerant, and faster, what you can see here. So before, it took us 15 minutes to build up a service with these kernel container mechanisms. We have now really the possibility in 2 minutes to build up a service. You don't need this complex hotfix management anymore, files deployment here and there. We just deploy new containers overriding the old functionality. And this, all this really enables us from our side flexible control on the deployment. When do I put a service where, how, and so on. So I can really control this and have a kind of auto-scaling the system, because the timing here really allows me to provide new services and shut down others. Really flexible. Next thing is the smart update. So we talked so far about single services, but I would like to bring the whole thing to a new version, for instance, to 6.12 or to 7. So this is the version update. And there so far what we did is we only had one system, and we did the update of the system and the upgrade of all customers, all 800, 900, which are in one system at the same time. So this took a long time. This was 15 hours, 17 hours. It was a high risk thing because things could fail. And what we did now, we separate this. So we have the chance to build up a new system completely separately, and then moving each of the customers separately, with even upgrading them to the new version. So this is something which provides us really a smart update, as we say it, less risk in the update procedure, and also having less downtime with less than 2 hours, what we sometimes only 10 minutes, 15 minutes per customer downtime. So this is really a big difference to what we have currently. The last thing is cloud first rollout. What we see here, what we wanted and what we do now is rolling out or making available the cloud first and only then roll out on premise. And in addition, we give new systems, or we can sell new systems first, and then we do upgrades. So this is a new methodology what we would like what you introduce with 7 now also, and which really gives us, let's say, less risk, and also really is a cloud-first rollout. So overall, from the deployment rollout, we are really, really better in everything we do here. So it's faster, stable service deployment during runtime, so flexible control on what we do, and also we are ready now for additional systems, because we can simply build them up. We can even migrate customers from here to there, and we can also more easily set up new Azure data centers. On the other side, faster and less risky version updates. This is what I said with the smart update, reducing operation failures, and reducing our effort also in this respect. And finally, also from the rollout, we are a cloud-first company. So these are really major achievements from our side. Together with the scalability, what I explained before, with these deployments, this is a much, much more different thing what we have with version 7. So looking in the future from the architecture side, so what we still would like to do is replacing the old workflow server, move the notification server to the BPS, do further performance optimizations. Here we are not yet at the end, although these numbers are pretty impressive. And Docker Kinetic solutions will also be enabled for existing organizations, and we will move desktop parts to the server, for instance, from the scanning part. On the cloud side, we would like to have custom-specific sender mail addresses. Additional Azure data centers will be built up, specifically Germany and France. And we have easier integration with Docker Cloud, meaning that the current Active Directory integration will be extended towards single sign-on, and the provisioning of third-party web services should also be extended for Azure. So this concludes from my side, let's say, the first strategic direction to cloud, right? So we are hope you still have energy. So this is so this was just the first column. Moving to the second one, this is high usability, because it's also important. So, since some years, we worked already on moving the Docker administration up to the web-based Docker configuration. And with version 7, we also moved parts here from the file cabinet administration up to the web configuration. So, there are examples here. Predefined workflows, auto index, deletion, export are now there with new GUIs in the configuration part. The migration workflow moved to an external service. We moved the user management now completely to the web configuration. We also eliminated the current, restrictions we had there. So you can have 50,000 users managing in this GUI now finally. And auditing document history configuration moved also up there. So this is something which is really helping us, which is nice from the usability point. In future, we would like still to extend the user management thing, because groups, roles, and profile management are still missing, and we will also extend the stem configuration. And by this, if we have done this, so the whole file cabinet administration, hopefully in 2018, this is then really possible in the web configuration. And the Docker admin tool, Docker administration, is only for system administrators left. Next thing, we already reworked existing configurators, so we also did this and continued this with Docker version 7 here, so reworked specifically import, printer, and scanner to much nicer usability, and redesigned the configuration overview. The plan still to have it in 2018 is the Smart Connect configurator, because this is the only thing which remains in Silverlight. So this is the only thing where we still have, and then we are rid of it, right? So then we have all this nicely in HTML5, and we also would like to rework the Connect to Mail configurator. You can express your feelings. High usability also on the web client. So here we put also some focus. Specifically, we added the auditing in the web client, so that you can really, if you go to a document, you can get the history from the result list. And you have the better view and filter possibilities, and you're also easier to create audit reports. So for compliance reasons, you're much better prepared now. Here, and there are also several smaller examples, or several smaller enhancements, which are done here. There are some few listed, the copy paste from result list was possible. The scan button now directly installs the desktop. We only show select list symbol when it's really configured, and the viewer, we store the position from the zooming, manually. So, high usability. Another great example for high usability is our Dockerware Mobile. Since we have seen more and more using this module, we have seen the potential here, and we decided to rework it, to re-implement it even in the fourth generation. We have now all use cases covered, which are also in Mobile 3. From the UI perspective, it's much nicer, much easier to handle. And also from the usability perspective, newest technologies are used as a C-sharp Xamarin with a native UI. We provide this for iOS and Android, and the Dockerware versions from 6.10 on are supported. Plans are, in the next steps now, offline support. This is something which is wished for long term. Also to support workflows and forms, and also to integrate mobile indexing, that means intelligent indexing, in the mobile. But we are prepared now with this new platform, we can have offline support. The next, or the last thing what I would like to mention just on the usability part is the paper scan. We see here also great potential, because we're just looking at the numbers, there are about 120,000 downloads meanwhile, and we have really 8,700 active users monthly, which is giving us some potential. And the other thing what you see here, we got granted a patent from the US Patent Office about the base mechanism in the background, so really detecting the document and capturing it. So all this together made us think, yeah, let's do it in a better, nicer way. We did, starting for iOS now, UI redesign. We integrated here already intelligent indexing, so you can switch it on if you want, so that you get really directly indexing features, and we discontinued by this the mobile app, paper organizer. Plans are here, Android support, of course, and rework scan quality, because we see there are some issues with the scan quality, and we are integrating this with some enterprise file share systems. This concludes. There are still more examples, but just want to mention these ones here. This is really a usability boost, also with version 7, what we made here, and inside the version for all the kind of users, and this brings us really a step forward. Let's move to a short outlook also on some other future topics which were not addressed by the models by the changes I just mentioned. So we will focus in the future also to improve the usability on the web client. Endless scrolling of view and lists is one of the topics. Reviewing performance is another topic, and harmonization, for instance, for views of dialogues, for instance, for store and login dialogues, because there are different ones all over in the system. The other topic is the business process modeling. So here, we would like to provide an easy, or a UI for easy definition of your processes. So this is something which is really for everyone who can use it. Easy creation, human readable processes, collaborative editing enabled, step ready, easy to print out and to use it for all your documentation of business processes. This brings me to the third column, third focus area was utility, or is utilities, rich utilities. Here I would like to start with the improved capture. There are mainly two things, so it's improved capture and the workflow. Improved capture, one example is Dockerware Forms. Here we enhanced the forms design by one thing is the text field layout. It means you can select the fonts and you can also add hyperlinks. On the other side, correct the data entries like usage of file cabinet select lists is in there. Dynamic field behavior, that means there are dependencies from the entrance in one field related to another one. And field mask support is also added. So these are the things which are in 7. Planned are validation of the form field entries. Planned is also now pre-filled fields like system values like date, user. We have database lookups. Also call this autofill. And also we would like to add table fields. Maybe table fields, I have to say, you will see this in several of the modules. This is an underlying strategic thing to really provide tables as a field. The other thing, improved capture, we added an instant indexing in auto-index, so that means that you can change immediately, or you can, whenever a document arrives, you have immediately the possibility to change the index data. You can continuously work with this already indexed document right at the beginning. And the other thing is connector outlooks. You have single instancing, which is enabling, or which is ensuring that the same email which was sent to different receivers is only stored once in your file cabinet. And then you have the big advantage when you search that you only get it once and not 10 times because everyone was storing it. On the other side, the workflow manager. So here we could see already what you see up there on the right corner, the usage. So 64% of the new customers, cloud customers in 2017 were already using the workflow manager. So this is an increased usage of the component. And based on this and also the experiences we made with the old engine, which was based on the Microsoft core, we were deciding to re-implement the whole workflow engine for higher performance, more interactive, more scalable and modular, because we need to handle it better and we have to provide a better engine here. So we also implemented, re-implemented the whole thing. We made a microtransaction model in the backend so that you decouple from the GUI and the task processing on the backend side so that on the GUI you're faster and the backend still continues running the workflow tasks, and the workflow and main database are merged just for performance reasons and for fault tolerance. So overall, if I say performance, also here, we measured something, so the, depending on what you measure, but I put it here, so from what we've seen, 17 to 100% performance increase with the new workflow engine. So this is also a great achievement. Thank you. Plans are filtering of task lists. So, because maybe step back. So, because we are now doing or did a major work on the platform itself, we did not put any new features in there. So. But this is now what is coming based on the new platform or the new workflow engine. We put filtering of task lists, one click decision if there are several activities. We have the table fields, split booking, what we would like to add also here. Work on forms inside the workflow, really routing the forms in it and fill it out by different people, and adding intelligent indexing in the workflow. This really gives us from the utility side with version 7 extension of powerful utilities, capture workflow, what I mentioned, and we really strengthen with this our enterprise-ready cloud platform. For the future, in addition to what I mentioned on capture and workflow, there are things for sure in the web client we would like to address, also table fields for sure, and folder management, we started it already and we would like to do the next step, for instance, putting cover pages there and also supporting handwritten signature support. Another major topic for us is an easier integration with Dockerware, so there are some topics mentioned here, easier deployment of partner applications, then also call external web services from the web client so that you get a hook and can call web services from the result list, from the viewer, and the last thing also to strengthen our SDK community. All right, so this was utility. Now you're almost at the end, it's quality, which is left. So outstanding technical quality is a main thing. Even if we see that with the cloud success what we have, we move more and more from a, let's say, product company to a really cloud service company. And quality is key there because you would really not affect all the customers when there are some issues. We don't want issues at all, let's say. So we put there a high, high effort in it, and I would like to go through a little bit through the development cycle to express a little bit what we've done. So starting in the development cycle is the first thing is the product. So product takes care of product concepts, UI concepts, And here, for sure, it's always on time, being on time, delivering great product, concepts, and do it well thought, and even have user testing. So we extended here the team. We extended also the processes. The next level, the technical concepts. So we also have, let's say, here extended towards really concept review, technically wise, ensuring high quality architecture. We build guilds so that they have cross-team discussions about technical topics. And on the next level, we have, let's say, then the development itself. It's the coding. Here, the main part is the coding quality, which we have to keep up. So on the one hand side, we really do quality or code quality checks. On the side, we really extended load tests here to find some issues in the, implementation, also build automations or gated check-ins, that you really do this on a more frequently from the build side and from the check-in side, checking before really something is going into the code. The next level of only is the QA. The QA is the gatekeeper from what R&D produces. So they really have the task to on a high test coverage from ever what we produce on the R&D side. And here we added real-world tests, more towards real-world tests. Also the artificial lab tests, what we had. Test automation is an important thing because we have to automate many, many, many tests and run them every night. So this is where we are at the moment. And we added also a specific cloud QA system. The next level is the operation part. And here for sure for the DevOps team, it's important to operate it in a stable way, to reduce risks, to reduce problems, update and rollout, and so on. All these are already mentioned what we did here. I don't want to repeat this. The next thing what we do is also eat your own dog food. So we do this since several years, since a long time, but we really extended this usage. So many, many, many business critical things are really inside Dockerware. So if you are not running a good in-house system on the cloud, then also our own business doesn't work. So we have lots of workflows inside. We're using almost all of the modules in-house for all the processes. So this is really extended, and this is a kind of test coverage also for our system. And we always use this or update this in the first place. So we suffer first if there's something wrong. Or not. So the last thing is, of course, you are partners, and this is the user side. Whenever there are things we couldn't catch in the whole, let's say, pyramid, it really reaches the end. But there, of course, we would like a high-level support. We changed already. We extended the SLAs. We put here new KPIs. We extended the escalation process also inside. So if there are things that we really address it immediately, and also we have low cycle time for fixes. So these are things which we address also here if there are some few things coming to the end. This is on the development cycle. There are four more things which are more vertical. The one thing is processes. Since we are a growing company, this is important. There are more and more people working on this. So we really have to establish, define and establish processes which are really kept, challenging KPIs which we defined, and also undergoing lots of certifications. The other thing is security. I see this as a part of quality. So here, we also have to get better. We increase the penetration tests. Meanwhile, we do twice a year penetration tests, and have our own security specialists in-house. Backward compatibility, as I told already, this is an important thing right at the beginning, because this is an affecting thing. When we do an update, this is affecting all the users there if the application doesn't run. So we really put here more effort on backward compatibility. Maybe we were not so sharp here in the past, but we really learned our lessons. We did here procedural updates, changes. We do constant checks. And if there are necessary backward compatibility breaks, then we have release notes. So this is something you will get with version 7, clear release notes, and there should be no other surprise than what is in there, nothing else. And this we will continue with lots of effort. Combining these both, security and backward compatibility, maybe referring to last year, there were some security holes in the system. We fixed them right away. because we would like to prevent damage to all the customers, all the systems. So this is really a difficult thing for us. We fixed it. Of course, unfortunately, there were some backward compatibility issues with this, and I'm really sorry for this, and that this caused inconveniences on your side and also especially on the customer side. But I think I'm still convinced that we do the right thing, and I will do the same thing again if we are finding security holes and they are backward. You have to break with the backward compatibility. I will do this again. Security is more important. And the last thing, use technology. This was always a goal. We used this on the one hand side of development, be faster, more stable on the other side, having also the chance here to do something new. But of course, if you do this too early with newest technologies, you have a quality risk. So there's really a tricky thing from our side to balance this inside the software. I would say really substantial enhancements of the product and service quality, what we deliver with version 7, and we will also continue this. So this brought me now to the end of my presentation. Maybe I would like to summarize this with one sentence. In my point of view, we have done something really, really great. We have here a major milestone, which is really a breakthrough, which is really the base for the next years with version 7, so we will see this. We have now a modern cloud platform, which is also a modern cloud and on-premise platform. We have a usability boost, we have renewed and added important utilities, we have substantial steps towards outstanding quality, and the only question now remains, right, when do you get it? One thing, you get some more details in the next presentations again, so from product show and also the cloud keynote, we'll touch on some other things here. And the main thing is rollout. So we implemented it already, installed it already in-house in March, so it's running since then on our own business processes, and we're still there, so we're still making business. So the goal is here in May, rolling out and making available the beta system, also for ES. We did it already beginning of the week for EMEA, so you get it next week. Then still in May, we will do the new sales version 7 from the cloud available, and we will ship it on premise, and also in May, and then we will do in a period of time, maybe from June to September, doing the upgrades. I wish you all great success with our new platform, as well as us, and thank you very much for your attention.